Well, thank you for the opportunity to have a chat, Julian. As you said, I've been doing this for a little while. Greg, Mr. and I first met when I was involved in a project, one of the very early attempts to set up strategic management of predator pests. And what I'm going to talk about today is the pretty much the basics of what you need to do to set up a plan. So this is one of our issues, obviously, but I just thought I'd show you that because it's an interesting photo of a feral cat in the northeast of New South Wales. And I'd also like to acknowledge country. All the fieldwork that I've done and the management planning I've done is on lands that occur many First Nations people across the country. And I acknowledge the elders past, present and future. And of all the lands upon which we work, and today I come to you from Wiradjuri country in the central west of New South Wales. Strategic management is pretty important. And we have an adage which was developed by Guy Ballard, who's in the photo there. You can do something, you can do nothing, or you can do something useful. Doing nothing and doing something often have the same outcome, just that doing something costs you a bit more. So we choose to do something useful, and it usually costs you more than you think it's going to cost. And the first thing you need to do something useful is to plan it. So when you think about predator management, so I mean wild dogs, foxes, and feral cats, conceptually it's a pretty simple idea. But there's some basic principles you need to think about. It's the situations in which they occur that is important, not the species. The species aren't evil or virtuous. They just are. And it's the situations where they affect values that we have that are important, whether they be environmental, social, or agricultural values that we want to protect. So look at the situation, not the species itself. The next thing to think about is manage for the impacts, whether they be negative, positive, or neutral. And don't just count the tally of dead animals because that won't tell you much about what the effect on the impacts is of those controls. Remember that the predators can be damaging, neutral, or beneficial, and manage them according to that. So if they're damaging, you do something about it, reduce their numbers and exclude them. If they're neutral, you do nothing. And if they're beneficial, and there's potential for that, if they're beneficial, well, you encourage their numbers. There's a few adages that go along with that. First thing is don't rely on one method of control or exclusion or management. Prevention is better than cure, although in a lot of cases we're already in a situation where we need to cure. But if we can cure and then prevent going forward, the long-term outcomes are going to be better for whatever the asset is that you're trying to protect, and the long-term costs are going to be less as well. Talking about what we're here for today, failure to plan is planning to fail. I think that, okay, that's a nice trite little saying, but it's worthwhile having in the back of your mind. The other thing is something that Jill touched on, is that predators don't recognise boundaries unless you've got a very effective exclusion fence or you're an island and you've got water all around. So be tenure blind. Don't worry about who owns the land. The animals don't know that. So if we enact our plans in relation to the home range sizes and the movements around the landscape of the animals that we're interested in, we're going to have a much better effect than if we control according to pocket handkerchief sized blocks of public land or single properties. But then once you've got those ideas in mind, how do we go about doing it? How do we go about this planning process? So I've got a management cycle that you could use to plan to go on a holiday if you wish. It's a pretty simple sort of an idea, but it's a cycle because it allows you to go around and do what you need to do, evaluate what's happened, and then go around the next year. And so it's a continuous, ongoing, active living plan. And the key thing about it is defining the problem. The second thing is, once you've defined the problem, you've got to have equity amongst all the stakeholders who are sharing that problem. And they also have to have equal capacity, or their capacity has to be at a minimum standard in order for the plan to be effective. By equity, I mean they don't have to have the same amount of money, they just have to have the same amount of responsibility. So if you're a manager of private land, you have the final say about what money is spent and what activities occur on your land. Whereas if you're a public land manager, quite often you have to go up through multiple levels of approval before you can actually get something happening on the ground and make sure that you've got a budget and all those sort of things. So sometimes there's not equity of ownership. And so how do you get around that needs to be considered. And also the capacity thing needs to be dealt with. And I'll deal with that in a bit more. Capacity was the center of that Venn diagram that Julian showed you at the end there. Very importantly, is that once you've defined the problem, you need to set clear and measurable goals. It's not just saying foxes are evil, so therefore we should kill all of them. You've got to actually have an idea about what the impacts are that you are trying to protect, and then set in place a way of measuring those so that you can set up goals that are measurable and you can see whether or not you've done anything about it. The next thing to do is to devise the plan of action, the living plan, the working plan, which integrates all the control tools that you need. Remember I said don't rely on one method. Integrates all those in a timed plan that has an end date on it and sets out who's responsible for doing which part of the plan, when they're expected to do it, how they coordinate with other groups, and so on. And then when are you going to report what's happened? The next thing is obviously the Nike bit. You go and do it. But very importantly is you need to monitor. So in your planning, the step before, you need to include what your monitoring will be. By planning and doing it, monitoring, you're then able to evaluate what happened. How did it go? If it went well, you modify and progress around the circle. No change is necessary. However, the advantage of this cycle that I've got here is it can tell you at which point that your plan needs adjustment. So if we go along the bottom line here, it may be that your actions weren't quite right. You know, maybe you did it at the wrong time, or maybe you didn't have enough people involved. Maybe you didn't put out enough bait. Maybe you didn't make your fence fox-proof or cat-proof. Maybe those sort of things need to be revised. Maybe your goals were unachievable or overachieving. So maybe you said you want to increase your lambing percentage by 5% and you achieved 10%. So maybe next time you want to make it, so we've revised it up to, we want to have another 5% increase in our lambing production. It might be something like by the end of year dot, we actually want to have an increase of three families of spotted tail quolls, something like that. Whatever your goal is, has to be something that's measurable so you can revise it if necessary. Quite often it's the capacity that's not equal. So you need to think about how you go about raising that capacity, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later on. If things are really bad, you may need to redefine the problem. So, for instance, you might have thought that you had a problem that was fox predation when, in fact, it was a pig predation issue, or it was a combination of dogs and foxes or foxes and cats or so on, and you might have been targeting only one of the species when you needed to target more of them. Or maybe you had ill-defined the boundaries in which you were going to do your work. So there's a whole lot of ways that you can look at the defining the problem and fix it up. But hopefully you've done all the work at the beginning, which is defining the problem, and then most of the other stuff will fall into place nicely afterwards. So one of the things that you need to do when you're defining the problem, and one of the things that I missed out here was the why, which is what Gillian talked about, because that talks about the motivations of people to participate in a group control program or group management program. So the what is the problem? Is it an asset, conservation asset that you want to protect? And also, what is the cost of that? What is the cost in terms of control? What is the cost in terms of the losses of the asset? And you need to have some idea about the measurement of that before you go into it. Or maybe one of the things you need to do is, as part of your management plan, is to actually assess that while you're undertaking your first bits of control. Where is pretty important, and there's two things about the where. One is, where are the foci that you want to concentrate on? Where are the assets that you might be trying to protect? Say, for instance, you're interested in brush-tailed rock wallabies. The centres, the foci points for their distribution would obviously be a starting point for where you would do some fox control. But the scale about where you might do it would depend on which other animals that are likely to be causing you problems, whether you've got wild dogs, cats in the area. So that'll set the scale at which you need to do it. So where has those two components? When is obviously important from the point of view of when do you get the best bang for your buck in terms of control activities, and when are the critical points of time in the seasons of the animal you're trying to protect? It's not much point just doing your work for shorebirds when they're not there. You might want to do them immediately before they arrive at the breeding sites. You might need to have ongoing planning to get people to maintain their cats and dogs and foxes at home. You might have to talk to local four-wheel drivers to make sure that they're also coordinating their activities at times when the shorebirds aren't breeding. How do you go about it? That's fairly important. Work out how you implement your control. And that leads on to who is involved. And there are two levels of who is involved. There are people that are immediately involved, so the stakeholders who have an interest in it. And then there's the next level, which are the people that might be neighbours. So, for instance, if you're trying to do a protection in a conservation area, don't just think about the conservation area as the focus of your work, because you might have sheep producers or goat producers on the outside who also are interested in the same issue but from a slightly different point of view. So make sure you include those stakeholders and identify during the definition who are the people that are likely to be a problem. And as Gillian said, you don't have to involve everybody to start off with, but you may be able to work around them. They may not be important in the context if they're small. And if they are important, you then have to come up with a strategy to go and involve them if you can, and work out the why. Why are they not involved? And then what can you do about getting them involved? So it's a people issue. The who bit of it is the critical component of it. And just so people know who've seen that picture on the front of the old management guidelines, that was a frozen eastern barbed bandicoot. When you define the problem, it's all about the impacts, as I mentioned before. So just reiterating this issue again, why do we want to measure the impacts? Well, simply to inform the management with data about the issue, not some general motherhood statement. You need to know what the level of problem is. So on the right-hand side there, we have a picture of foxes with their tails removed along a fence line. But that tells you absolutely nothing about what the problem was. It tells you nothing about what the initial populations of these animals were. It tells you nothing about how many are left in the environment and whether or not the impacts are still going on, whatever they happen to be. So you need that information so you can set your measurable objectives. The other thing to do is to map any knowledge that you have. When you're starting a planning process, the first thing to do is to convert your oral history to written history. And the best way to do that is to put a map down in front of people and get them to draw lines, put dots on the map. And so you get all the knowledge of all the different people and the people who've been involved in the past. So you can get yourself a benchmark of what current knowledge is, where and when the impacts occur, what controls occurred and so on. And just as a simple thing, if you don't measure the impacts and measure the control efforts and so on, there's no way that you can manage the issue. So just to give you a couple of examples, the negative impacts that we know about foxes and cats on Australian wildlife is that we've got predation, direct predation, which is an obvious issue for critical weight range animals, and also other things like mallee-fowl and shorebirds. And foxes are listed for 28 species. Feral cats, we're not sure how many species are affected by them, but that's why I've got the XX there. But once again, they're mostly CWR animals and reptiles and birds. But the recent paper by Trish Fleming et al., where she looked at the diets across the nation and across history, it shows a great deal of overlap in the species that are affected adversely by feral cats and foxes. So quite often you would want to be doing a management plan that incorporated both species. They're also implicated in diseases of animals and humans, and there's just a list of a few. Foxes also have the nasty habit of spreading weeds, and if you wandered around when blackberries have berries on them, you'll see lots of fox poos that are just loaded up with blackberry seeds and are quite often purple. But from that, if you're writing your plan or developing your plan, think about what are the local or the regional losses that you're trying to protect. And what are your local or regional control costs? And they will differ according to the landscape that you're in, the actual tenure of the people that you're dealing with, and the size of the control area that you need to incorporate to be effective. We know that foxes have negative impacts on agriculture, and cats do as well with the spreading of disease. They also impact on human health, with cats with toxo being not a good thing for people to get. Once again, there's a few negative impacts that you can measure, and by measuring those, deciding what's an acceptable or a reasonable target, it gives you something to aim for. Think about it locally, and then think about it regionally. What are your local losses? What are the animals that are being affected by fox predation and maybe cat presence as well? And what are the local control costs? Not just the ones that are being applied now, but what is it going to cost to apply an effective control program? And usually you need to think about the scale, and that will determine how much effort and dollars need to be put in place to make a difference. And usually the issues in supposedly unsuccessful programs are that there's the distribution of the control tool is inadequate, the intensity of the control tool is inadequate, or the frequency, or a combination of all three. And I've put those two maps up. The one on the left is of 15 home ranges of foxes. And you can see the white line is, the majority of that white line is a dog-proof fence. And if you look at the right-hand map, you can see that the fence is fairly effective in keeping the dogs to the right of the fence. But if you look back at the left-hand one, there's a fair bit of overlap where a number of the foxes don't recognise that dog-proof fence. So obviously, if you wanted to make a fox-proof, you'd have to decrease the mesh size, maybe have a floppy top on it and so on. But the important point about that is you need to look at the scale. If dogs and foxes are your problem, you need to look at the dog scale, not the fox scale, in order to set your management unit. The capacity bit was the one that I really think that we need to think about. Not everybody that comes into a meeting or has some concern about a particular issue has the same capacity. And the things that limit our capacity in general are our knowledge, the amount of time that we have, or the amount of money that we have to spend on the issue. So we can easily fix the knowledge. One of the things that you're doing today is increasing your knowledge. And there's a number of things there. You've got the research outcomes that is published, the monitoring that you're doing, or the monitoring you plan to do, that'll increase your knowledge of distribution and abundance of the animals you're targeting, but also the effects they're having on the assets that you're trying to protect. The other things about knowledge is it's increased by discussion in your group. Different people bring different things, different skills, different knowledge, different experience. And that's those interactions and discussions, which are obviously, you get a cumulative improvement of the knowledge across the group, and you also get interactive knowledge. So if you have two people, you have two lots of ideas, but if you have two people talking together, you end up with three lots of ideas. It's the same sort of principle. Time is a critical component, and you need to have acknowledgement that you're going to have to dedicate time to the issue, initially in the planning issue, the planning process, and then later in the activities that you might do and the monitoring that you might do. So dollars is always going to be a problem, but if you want to be effective, you've got to make sure that the investment that you put in is adequate to the size of the problem or the management unit that you're dealing with. Now, sometimes if you don't have time, you can buy time by outsourcing. So that's fine, assuming you've got enough money. Maybe you don't have enough money in the kitty of the land managers that are dealing with this issue, and so you need to outsource that and get some grants or whatever. But you've also always got to have that capacity to be able to do something effective. And if you haven't got all that, you've got to work on it until you've got a certain level of capacity so you can start. Another thing that limits people's ability to be effective in wildlife management is quite often they're unfamiliar with the tools that are available and have how you would best apply them. There's a lot of misinformation about the impacts of some of the poisons that are out there, and that unfamiliarity with the realities of those tools will quite often limit people's involvement. The other thing is that, particularly with farmers, you're used to dealing with people that work on their own, and working in groups requires a different level of socialising that they mightn't be familiar with. Also, you may have issues where families haven't got on for generations, or they don't like the national park next door or whatever. And so that's something that needs to be overcome. And good facilitators are really important in that, because they can set up a situation where it's non-threatening for the participants, and they can work out where their common goals are, their common attitudes and values, and that can really help to overcome some of the reticence that might be there in the first place. Another thing to think about is what in your goals, very rarely is eradication a realistic goal for a pest animal. The only time where it really fits is in island situations, and then there's small islands usually. And it depends once again on the species that you're looking at and the scale of their home range. But the essential criteria for eradication is, can you remove more than the rate of increase of the population? And can you do that at all population densities? So can you do it when there's lots of them, and can you do them when there's not many of them? You've got to compensate for their natural rate of increase, their inherent rate of increase. You've also got to have no immigration into the area that you're dealing with. So obviously a fence or an island, that's where that problem is solved. The other thing about it is that all the reproductive animals need to be at risk of the control tools and strategies that you're applying. Because if you don't, if you can't get all those reproductive animals, you know, they're just going to replace themselves again after you've stopped doing what you're doing. There's also a few criteria that are are helpful. So if you're monitoring, you need to be able to monitor them at low densities. An example of that is the camera trapping that was done at the Pilliga, where they had Rambo, a fox that they couldn't kill, but they kept seeing him and seeing him and seeing him until they finally, after a couple of years, they were able to get him. And they were able to keep the monitoring going to show that their the animals were absent from the enclosed areas. The next one is an economic system, evaluation. Got to work out whether doing your analysis of the benefits of the costs that you're putting in, does it favour eradication or ongoing suppression at a very low number? Now, that may not be real, may not be a real thing for some animals that you might want to protect. You might need absolutely none. And so in that case, eradication is actually the benefit comes out on top. The other thing is you've got to be, people have got to be willing for the control programs to happen. So that's your suitable social, socio-political environment. So just in summary, not eradication is usually not possible. So ongoing management is necessary usually. There's a really important underlying thing that you need to think about in terms of if you are going to control these animals by reducing their population size, how much do you need to do? So what you actually need to do it for controlling a species is to reduce its rate of increase so that it's less than zero. So rate of increase, one of the measures of rate of increase goes from positive one to negative one. So you've got to get it into the negative space. You've got to obtain a population level where the impacts are acceptable or negligible. So that means in reducing your population down, you've got to get it to that low point where the impacts are negligible. It's no good reducing it. You might think a 50% reduction is significant. It might be significant from a statistical point of view, but if 50% of the population of foxes, for instance, is still going to wipe out your shorebirds or your brush-tailed rock wallabies or whatever, then it's not really an acceptable level. The other thing is after you've got it below zero and negative territory, you've got to keep it there. So that's where your ongoing management comes into play. The converse applies for the conservation. If you want to stop an animal going extinct, you've got to make sure that its rate of increase is above zero. So you've got to do your population control of your invasive species to such an extent that the rate of increase of your thing that you want to conserve is above zero and maintains it above zero over time. So management will be continued. But that talks, the inverse of that, or the converse of that, is how much do I actually need to reduce the population by in order to get that rate of increase into negative territory? So for cats, it's been calculated that you need to knock out a proportion of about 57%, but up to 93% of a local population, because they can breed, if the conditions are right, sort of almost continuously, and they have litters, so they can replace themselves very quickly. Likewise with foxes, although they only breed seasonally, they have litters and so they can increase their numbers very quickly year to year. So the annual reduction you need for them is 0.65. So those are the sort of reduction levels that you're actually aiming for. But the important thing about those numbers is what they do is they maintain the population at the equilibrium value that they are at the time. If you want to reduce the populations and send them into negative territory, you actually have to do more work than that. And the other thing is to think about if you're controlling predators and you want to say foxes are what you see as your main problem, you've got to think about what combination of predators is there because that's going to impact on what control effect you have on the foxes, which might be your primary target. So if you've got dogs there, you've got to think about those. If you've got cats as your main issue and you've got foxes there, you probably have to get rid of the foxes and the dogs before you can have a crack at the cats. So let's go back to this cycle. The important thing, as I said before, define the problem. Get that right and most of the other things will fall into place. Importantly, though, the temptation for people is to get in and do stuff. They want to devise their plan of action and get stuck in straight away. So don't start over there and, more to the point, don't start here at the do it and monitor stage. Start back at the start and get yourself with a really good definition of what you want to do, what the problem is, who is involved, when you're going to do stuff. Get that all sorted before you really get into doing stuff. Final slide is to show you that a management plan doesn't have to be complex. What I've shown you here is a map which basically captures all the activities in a wild dog and fox management plan set up by the Brindabella Wee Jasper Wild Dog and Fox Management Group. This is from their 2005 to 2010 strategic plan. They started off in 2001 with a 15-page document. They reduced it down to a 4-page document, of which one page was the sign-off of all the participants, so all the people who were authorised to act on behalf of the various groups that were represented. The next page was a record of the impacts that had happened over time and had a record of what had happened during the previous year. And the next page was a list of the activities, when they were going to occur. It was just a table, a list of the activities, when they were going to occur and how much it was going to cost and who was going to do it. So very simple. So you can get it down to effectively a 2-page living plan. And the other thing that's important about it is to have a review date, at least have it annually, so that you can see where you're up to. And so that's where you evaluate and decide whether you just keep going around doing the same thing or whether you progress on to changing something, whether it be the definition right through to the actions. And it also gives you this plan. It should have a map of the assets that you try and protect. The other thing is, if you turn up to a meeting and you don't have a map there, go home. The reason being is there's twofold. First of all, a map is a good way of converting the oral history from all the different participants and stakeholders into written history. It's a benchmark. It's a starting point. The second thing is a map is a great community engagement tool. You put a map down on the table and all those blokes that are sitting around the edges of the meeting with their arms folded and looking at their feet, they all come over and start pointing at the map. It gets people working together and it gets people to understand how their part of the country fits into all the stuff that fits around them. Really good thing to have a map. So that's where we're at. So don't ask me questions now. Ask at the end. But thank you very much for listening.